Hello, hello, everybody. I am here with the wonderful Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who's running in New York's 14th district for the U.S. House of Representatives. And she's a Justice Democrat. She's a great candidate. And boy, oh boy, does she have some stories to share for us. So Alexandria and I were talking earlier in the week, and she let me know basically about how the sausage is really made when it comes to politics in America. And even though I follow this stuff on a regular basis, obviously, Alexandria, it blew me away. Like, I was like, are you serious that this is the way things function? So first, let's just start with, tell me, we were supposed to do this interview a little bit earlier today, but we had to push it back a little bit. Why don't you go ahead and tell everybody why that is?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, you're actually kind of getting a scoop here, Kyle, because I'm planning on going a little more public with this tomorrow or later this week, but I'll give you the scoop here. Basically, what's going on is that we are finding out that there is an appeal to the circuit court. There's a lot of complexities involved, but at the end of the day, basically what's happening is that the establishment is trying to move a polling location, a voting location, ahead of our federal congressional primary. And the timing is very, very specific because only federal congressional primaries are happening in June. So no race is happening in Queens except mine in June. And coincidentally, right before that time, we have this appeal out of nowhere to move a polling location out of a heavily progressive community, which also happens to be a very independent African-American, Latino voters, et cetera, in the district. But it's known to be a staunchly progressive community. It's known to be a community that bucks against the usual establishment candidates. And it's not the first time that Queens County or the local the local machine has tried to move the polling location out of this. Actually, I fought last year to maintain that polling site in that location last year, and we won that fight in court. And lo and behold, right before my own primary, they're trying to move it again, even though the court ruled that that it had to stay. And so they're trying to fight the courts again. They're trying to turn it over in courts again. They do have the influence there. The ball is kind of in their court, but we're organizing and we're about to help amplify the voices that want to keep their polling location.
So this is, just to sum that up for everybody, that's a voter suppression technique.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's not up in the air. It's not a matter of conjecture. That's what you do when you want to try to throw a wrench in the election and try to hurt the progressive candidate, is you do something like you move a polling place at the last minute. And then what drives me crazy is, of course, these same, you know, corrupt Joe Crowley, as we call him, he'll go ahead and shriek about Republican voter suppression tactics when he himself is not a believer in small d democracy, and he absolutely proves that here. Mm-hmm. So tell me the story about the court case, about the potential court case and what could come and what corrupt Joe Crowley is trying to do.
So I think it's really important. I mean, Kyle, you and I are both New Yorkers, and so I think this issue kind of hits home for the both of us, even though we don't live in the same district, especially after the 2016 primary, when we saw all of those voters who were purged and the Board of Elections admitted to gross negligence after the fact, this kind of strikes home for us. And I think it's important for us to kind of blow the lid a little bit on how bad New York's state of voter suppression and election law actually is, because people think that it's fine here because we're a blue state. But really, we have some of the worst election laws on the books in the country. With respect to this lawsuit, here's kind of the timeline of events. About a year ago, Joe Crowley essentially had a kind of a protege, his machine candidate that he wanted to install in city council. But his candidate wasn't particularly popular. And so there were about four candidates in the race. And so what they first did, which is they what the first thing that they did was that they bumped half the candidates off the ballot so that there were only two candidates left in the race. Those two candidates happened to be the only women in the race that they had bumped off. So now it became a two-person race. Then after that, what they tried to do is move this community's polling location outside and away from that central community, because that community is known to support Joe Crowley's opponent. So what was going on was that that's a whole partisan thing. Honestly, every candidate in this race was kind of all over the place. But they were basically trying to win the election by moving the poll site instead of actually trying to organize and win votes. So really, it's a very undemocratic way of trying to win. Like you mentioned, a very undemocratic with a small d kind of way of winning. And so they tried to move the polling location outside of this community. But there are a lot of longtime organizers. There are a lot of organizers from the 80s, 70s that really fought hard for African-American civil rights. And so they fought against and they took the case to court to keep their polling location. And they won, like miraculously. Everyone said, there's no way you're going to win against the machine. There's no way you're going to get this polling location back. They were able to get it back. They were able to get it back, not for their primary, importantly, but they got it back for the general election. Now that the next primary, the congressional primary, is coming up, they're trying to move it back. So that ruling that allowed that community to keep their polling location is now being appealed. And they're trying to appeal it, and they're trying to move it ahead of the primary once again, right before this congressional race. This is not about allowing people to vote. This is not about expanding the right to vote in the state of New York. This is about manipulating an election through manipulating poll sites. And that's not a clean win.
So he's trying to keep you off the ballot, right? Isn't that something he's trying to do?
This is a whole other thing. So as I had kind of mentioned earlier, in that kind of city council race that's a predecessor to this race in this particular community, is that I think it's really important for people to understand how a person can even run for office in the state of New York to begin with. In many states, you can do one of two things. You can either collect a certain amount of signatures to get on the ballot, or you can pay a ballot access fee. Some states only allow you to pay a fee, like Arkansas is really awful. There's a brand new Congress candidate out there in Arkansas, and he had to pay $15,000 for a ballot access fee just to run for Congress. You're not even allowed to collect signatures in the state of Arkansas for the GOP primary. You have to pay the ballot access fee, which basically guarantees a corporate or big money candidate.
Yeah, that's oligarchy right there. You have to meet Absolutely. This minimum threshold, and there's no way any normal person could hit it. So it's just rich people who run.
Yeah, absolutely. And so in New York, we don't have a ballot access fee, except the problem is that if it's one or the other, it ends up being expensive either way. So because when in New York, for a congressional race, you have to collect 1,250 signatures, except this is what we're facing basically in New York 14. My opponent is not just the congressman, but he's also the chairman of the Queens Democratic Party, which means that allows him to appoint almost every judge in the borough. So what happens is that on April 9th, April 10th, we have a window of about 4 or 5 days to hand in our signatures. The day we hand in our signatures, he's going to challenge those signatures in court, accuse us of fraud, essentially. And then that challenge goes to a judge that he's appointed.
My goodness.
So that is why our campaign has to collect thousands of signatures above that 1,250 signature requirement in order for us to make a really irrefutable, bona fide case to the court. Now, this is totally backwards. I mean, I don't need to tell you that.
Of course.
This system is being abused. This system has long been abused, not just by my opponent, this has been a this is just a this is not only a machine tactic, but this is just a bullying tactic to avoid grassroots candidates from really mounting any sort of campaign in general in the state of New York. Because by dragging us to court, not only do we have to collect thousands more signatures than we actually need, but now we need to raise tens of thousands of dollars in illegal fees so that he doesn't bleed us dry and force us to fold our campaign. Now, this is all uphill, but I do have to say that we have been organizing a movement, and we are fundraising, and we are collecting those signatures to meet this challenge, even though that challenge is unfair.
So how many signatures do you currently have?
So we're not allowed to technically say
how many. Then don't say. Let's not give Corrupt Joe Crowley anything where he can try to flip it back on us.
Right.
How about in terms of funds raised? Do you need to raise funds for the court case, correct?
Yeah, exactly. So what I can say is that we have to raise over $25,000 to prepare for a full legal challenge that's fully staffed. But I'm also very so we definitely need like any funds that anybody would be willing.
And let me just say for the signatures, just in case, because everybody who's listening is going to want to sign, but we'll just tell them it has to be from the district. So that's you know, the little wrench they throw at you. So if you're in New York's 14th district, you can sign. If you're not, you can't. And obviously, I don't know what percentage of people watching this would be in, you know, New York's 14th district. But money can come from anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So,
volunteers can come from anywhere, too.
Okay, so how can they donate for this?
Definitely. So if you can go to Ocasio2018.com, that's O-C-A-S-I-O. 2018.com/donate. We've been on a real kick. Our average contribution we just broke 11,000 donors to the campaign, and our average donation is actually $8 a piece. So we're trying to get to that Bernie 27, but we're doing really, really well in terms of numbers and volume, which is phenomenal. And they're also volunteering, because if you're a registered Democrat in the state of New York and want to take a little field trip to New York 14 before April 8th, anyone who's a registered Democrat can help us collect signatures. You just can't sign our petition.
So I saw you tweeted this the other day. You might have the record for small donors for any campaign in New York history.
Yeah, that's actually right. We're filing our FEC this week. So we have an FEC deadline this week, and that will kind of be our bar. But it's looking like our campaign has organized the largest amount of small donors of any congressional campaign in New York State history.
Wow. So that's awesome. I mean, that's the thing is your campaign, it's been getting very popular. I keep seeing, you know, pieces, whether it's in Now This or some other publication where they're covering you. And I think what made me stop and go, whoa, was the fact that even given all of this national press attention, they're still like upfront about their corruption and how they're trying to weasel their way out of a real challenge. Because that's the thing, they see you as a real challenge. So Corrupt Joe Crowley has no choice but to pull out all these stops to try to cheat. He feels like that's the only way he has a chance to win. I mean, this guy, I've discussed him before on the show, but the fact that he literally left in the middle of a debate about Wall Street regulation to go raise money from Wall Street donors. That's all you have to know about this guy. And then also, I heard you mention the fact that the district you're in is 70% people of color, and it's never had somebody who's a person of color represent them. And when I hear that, you know what I think of? I think of the gerrymandering in Mississippi, where they have over, 80-90% black residents, and then there's some white Republican who somehow represents them. It's like, that's the level of corruption that we're talking about here. I mean, this is madness.
Yeah, it's wild. And he was never elected to the seat to begin with. He was appointed the seat by basically his mentor, who was the previous incumbent. And so voters in this district have never really had a choice. The last primary here was about 15, 14 years ago. And so we haven't even had an election here in almost a generation. And meanwhile, Queens and the Bronx has changed a lot in that time. Our community has changed a lot. We're feeling the impacts of soaring cost of living in New York City and every other major city in the United States. And that's not done separately from our elected officials. There's a lot of people making money off of the soaring cost of living, and they're putting some of that funds into lobbying politicians to make it easier to make our lives even more expensive. So this is definitely related.
So I want to give a little piece of good news here, though. So first of all, he's one of the top Democrats, okay? He's one of the top ones. But do you remember a guy named Eric Cantor and what happened to him?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But a lot of people listening right now will be like, no, I don't remember Eric Cantor. Right, that's my point. He was one of the top Republicans. And then he got voted out, and he got voted out in a primary.
Yeah, I think it's a really there's a really interesting parallel here. It just happened in 2014, too, so not too long ago. And basically, Eric Cantor was being groomed to be the next Speaker of the House.
Right. Yep.
He got all the lobbyist money. You had John Boehner and you had Eric Cantor being groomed. It was not Paul Ryan that was supposed to be Speaker of the House. It was a fluke.
That's right.
What happened was that Eric Cantor had raised millions of dollars for his primary race, and he gets challenged by this nobody.
David Brett, a teacher.
Right.
He was a professor.
Right, a college professor that was seen as totally fringe, totally underfunded, etc. And the thing that's important to note about Eric Cantor is Eric Cantor outspent his opponent 10 to 1.
Yep, that
he
proves.
He demolished him in fundraising.
Yep.
And when Eric Cantor lost, it was a huge shock that rippled through the Republican establishment.
Yep.
And it was the beginning of the end. It was the beginning of the end of the Republican Party as we knew it. And unfortunately, on the right, there was really nothing. There was no cohesive vision besides the Trumpian one that we have today to really replace that. But on the left, and what we're working on today is a cohesive vision that includes Medicare for all, that includes no corporate influence in our elections, that includes a tuition-free college, a Green New Deal. We actually have the vision to replace the old compromised Democratic Party of the past to become a party that really champions working class people for the future.
Yes. So, you know, with the Tea Party, we disagree with them 100% ideologically, but they were an anti-establishment backlash.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what the thing people don't mention about the Tea Party is that it actually worked, because you have the Republicans have a majority in the House, they have a majority in the Senate, they have the presidency, they have the majority of state legislatures, and they have the majority of governors. So,
yeah,
imagine a populist backlash like what we're witnessing right now, but from the left.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're doing here.
Yeah, and whether we like it or not, that movement was grassroots. It really was.
Mm-hmm.
They went in onto their community boards, they went into their school boards while everyone else was sleeping, and they took over their systems. And again, we may not like it, but frankly, that is how our system was designed. Our system was designed for bottom-up governance. And when no one else is governing and when everyone else is asleep at the wheel, it allows people to really grasp at those tools. And so a lot of reclaiming our democracy is about all of us waking up and getting engaged again in the political process.
So let's go through just some basic issues here real fast so that everybody can know what you're running your campaign on. You mentioned Medicare for All already, so you're running on Medicare for All. Are you for a living wage?
Absolutely. Fight for 15.
Are you for free college?
Mm-hmm. Tuition-free college.
Are you for ending the wars?
Absolutely. We have to end the AUMF as well.
Are you for a new deal, a big infrastructure project?
Yep, that also includes transitioning to 100% renewable economy.
Are you for criminal justice reform?
100%. Rikers Prison is in our district, so this is very important.
So you want to ban private prisons?
Absolutely. We have to ban private prisons. We also need to boot a lot of these for-profit services that are starting to infiltrate our public prisons as well. We also need to end the war on drugs. We need to legalize cannabis. And we also need to reform our probation laws as well.
Okay. everybody listening, she's running for office. If you could vote for her if you're in New York's 14th district. That's amazing. I was just talking on my show the other day about how I'm legitimately jealous of it. Like, if I lived in California, I'd be able to vote for Alison Hartson. Mm-hmm. If I lived in your district, I'd be able to vote for you. If I lived in West Virginia, I'd be able to vote for Paul Jean Swearengen. If I lived in Las Vegas, I'd be able to vote for Amy Villela. I mean, all these amazing candidates, and here I am. I got nobody to fucking vote for.
John Faso's kind of close to you, and he's a new JD candidate, I think.
Running against Nita Lowey? No.
No, I don't think so. He's like in New York 19, I believe.
Okay, so that's not my district, I don't think. I like how I don't know. Nita Lowey's my representative. I know that much. So, but anyway, all right. So now everybody knows. One more time, just tell everybody where they can donate so that you can fight this preposterous legal battle because you have to because they're throwing it on you. Just let everybody know one more time.
Totally. It's Ocasio2018.com/donate, or you can also volunteer, Ocasio2018.com/volunteer. Or if you're in the middle of nowhere and aren't in our district, you can call voters too, Ocasio2018.com/call, and you can phone bank for us as well.
Okay, there you have it. Well, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, thank you so much for joining me. And obviously, you know, I wish you the best in your race.
Great. Thank you so much, Kyle.